So here I am on the Racket River, and I'm using water mixable oils, so I can use the river water just to thin it and add that special something. First thing I'm going to do is sketch in the composition. I'm using a burnt sienna, and then working farthest to nearest, I'm just laying in the big shapes, the big masses. I'm using soft brushes today because I'm painting on, it's a Strathmore oil paper, and I really like it. It's fairly inexpensive. It has a nice finish. It's thick like cardstock, but the paint lays on top very nicely. It doesn't sink in, and so I like it for these small sketches. So now the clouds were what initially drew me to this scene. So I'm trying to figure out a composition. It's a little difficult when they're moving. You just kind of have to make it up as you go. Putting in the darks of the undersides, trying to establish the big shapes. That was actually a little too blue. It'll get grayer the closer it gets. So I toned that down a little bit. And then there's some sky in the back there peeping through, adding those little holes above the trees that'll create a sense of distance. Keeping it light and loose. This brush, this is a rosemary brush, and it's nice, but honestly, I think any synthetic brush, you can get a cheap brush at Michael's, at Dick Blick's, it'll work just as well. I have this because I was curious. I'd heard a lot about rosemary brushes, so I wanted to see what all the fuss was about. So now I think the composition needs to be reworked a little. That was a little too symmetrical, I think, so I want to create more of an imbalance. Larger clouds on the upper right. And the white of the clouds, it's actually, today it was quite yellow, pretty warm white, because you had the sun trying to shine through, but then shining through the atmosphere and maybe the humidity. Softening the edges of the clouds. That's why the soft brushes work really well for this. Then going in, adding a little more highlights. People talk about sky holes a lot in trees, but I really like cloud holes. They give it a nice lacy effect because clouds aren't one solid mass. Oh, the gnats, they were just swarming. Ugh. Tis the season. Okay, now I'm getting ready to paint the falls.
Leave me alone.
I'm setting the stage here, painting around them, leaving the white, the darks of the rock, the shadows of the rocks. And adding a little more detail here and there. The light is changing, so that's bringing out some detail in the trees that I didn't see initially. Changes can be good or bad, like as the light change. Now I'm sort of building up the crashing waters, creating like a mist. So I'm building that up. I'm gonna put the water on the very top. But it's so far away, there's not much detail anyway. And I'm not wearing my glasses, so it's all a beautiful haze. When I paint water, I like to, it's just a lot of vertical and horizontal marks, just back and forth. Some people, they really like to blend a lot, blur it, and it looks nice in their paints, but I don't like it in mine. So I try to keep it pretty loose so you can see the distinction between the vertical and the horizontal. And somehow that just creates the illusion of water. Okay, so now there's this tree here, a pine tree, that is very characteristic of the Adirondacks. I'm going to put that in. Still, I don't want to overwork this. I want to keep this pretty loose. Now adding some detail to the rocks and boulders on the other side of the shore. Not being too precious. Oh, that light shafting in there. That was a good change, that the light changed. And then for distant tree trunks and fallen branches and stuff, I just use the palette knife to scrape that in. It feels like cheating, but it works. And the best part is peeling the tape off. So very satisfying. There you go. That took about an hour. Thanks for watching.